Well, buenos días. This is tu amiga Sandra Diaz, episode two of Buenos Días con Sandra Diaz. I am so excited today to have the honor and the pleasure to introduce to you guys one of my dearest friends. I met her in high school, and we've been friends throughout all these years. So without further ado, everyone, please welcome Janet Gonzalez King.
Hey
Yay!
everyone, buenos días con Sandra Díaz.
Good morning. So
Good
for those of you
morning.
who don't know, Janet is in California right now. So what time is it over there?
It's 5:30 in the morning.
But thank you so much for joining me. And like I've talked to you before, like I've always been so proud of you. I'm very fortunate to have you in my life as a friend, as a colleague, and then also I'm happy to be part of your life and being able to see everything that you've overcome, obstacles that you've overcome, and everything that you've done for yourself. So, you're from Mexico. How old were you when you were brought over?
I was 10 years old. My family came to LA first, and then we moved to Chicago about a year later. I was about 10.
And then how was your experience when you came at that time?
It was hard. It was hard being, I was an A-straight student back in Mexico, and coming over here and not knowing the language, feeling inadequate, always being bullied by my peers, calling me wetback and mojada. It was hard. It was hard.
I remember back when I met you, we were 14 in high school, right? And I think that we had a really pretty cool tight group. We all supported each other. We
We
all
did.
talked about our future goals. And then, we just had the time of our lives. By the time we were going to finish high school, I think most of us were wondering what we were going to do with our lives, right? Somebody became a teacher. Some people went to IT. Some of us went straight into the workforce. So how was it for you when you graduated from high school and thinking about going to college?
Well, that was almost like non-existent for me. Back then, we didn't have the help that they have for undocumented students, so I had to pay out-of-state tuition if I wanted to go to college. So to me, that was out of the question. I did not have the money. My parents did not have the money, so I was ready to go back to Mexico to go to La UNAM, and I had an amazing Master Sergeant. I was in ROTC, and he really tried to pull everything and anything to get me to go to the Marines. But unfortunately, because I was undocumented, I wasn't able to. However, on my graduation day, he gave me a card, and that card had a one-way ticket to LA. He knew that my sister lived in LA and she had an auto body shop. She was pregnant at that time and she wanted some help. So he was like, go see what your sister could give you, how she could help you. But I don't think that it's time for you to give up. Your parents did so much for you to come over here. Your mom and dad and family sacrificed so much for you to just throw the towel in and go back to Mexico. He got me a one-way ticket to LA, and that literally changed my life.
So let's take
So,
a moment now and let's give a round of applause to our teachers who made a difference in our lives because we didn't have teachers that cared about us.
yes. I've given him his flowers, so he's still like a father figure to me to this day, Mr. Sergeant Spada.
So then you went to LA, right? You went to California to start a life over there. And how did you become this auto body shop owner? Like I know you mentioned that your sister had a body shop, right? And how did you become an owner?
Well, 10 years into working in different body shops, I got married And literally a few months after I got married, I was offered to take over a shop that was failing. My aunt had a shop that it was ready to close, and she offered it to me. I wasn't happy where I was at because they were underpaying me. And I told her, it was just laughing at all. I was like, I can't buy it, but I'll lease it. And literally within 2 weeks, she called me and she said, were you serious? Because I'm about to kick my kid out. He hasn't paid my rent for 5 months and I'm about to lose the property. So I told my husband, he didn't have any experience in the body shop business. So he said, I don't know how we would do it. Can we pray about it? We held hands. We prayed that if that was, the best for our family, to give us the strength and the courage to get it done. And then when we opened our eyes, he said, so what do? And I said, well, we'll quit our jobs tomorrow. And we started with $30,000, which was nothing for a body shop, but sacrifice came with it. And now we're receiving the harvest.
It's like, I'm pretty sure that a lot of people, because I know when I went to go visit you, that a lot of people don't believe that you're like the owner, like a female is the owner of
No, they always think I'm the secretary.
a I love it though, right? Because like, no.
Yeah, no, they think I'm the secretary, and then I'd be low key. I don't tell them anything. They'll ask for the owner, and I'm like, oh, well, I'm one of the owners. And well, where's your husband? And they think that my husband is the one in charge. So I'll entertain them. I'm like, oh, Marcus, they want to talk to you. And then they'll start talking to him. He'll listen to their story. And then he's like, well, she's the one that actually does the estimating and talks to the insurance. So you're going to have to talk to her. So they kind of,
Yeah. And I know we were talking yesterday, and going back to you're saying there was a lot of sacrifice that went with it. You and Marcus actually lived in the shop when you guys first bought the shop before you
Yeah,
bought
for
your
2 years. We started from below zero at that shop because it was in real bad shape, clientele wise. Didn't know how bad it was till we got in there. And they say that to start a business, sometimes you got to be kind of naive and not know what you're gonna really go get into. And I think that that was our secret, being naive, thinking that we can make it happen with $30,000 and the will and power to get it done, right? So when we went in, literally 5 months in, we ran out of money. And we were working 16 hours a day, literally 16 hours a day, and still not being able to make ends meet. So at one point, I told my husband, I said, we're running out of money, and it's either the apartment, we lose the apartment, or we lose the shop. And we had a little storage room in the second floor of our warehouse. And we moved everything in there. His mother was petrified of us doing that. But we did it. We did it for 2 years, and that sacrifice paid off. We were able to buy our house within 2 years. So
That's awesome. I know. I remember when you were telling me when we will keep in touch here and there, and just when you said that you were living there, I was like, wow. But there's a lot of sacrifice that comes with things. I think a lot of people sometimes forget that you can't have everything sometimes all at once, and you have to be able to continue to look and envision the future. In order to have more, in order to have bigger things, and fulfill some of those dreams. So I know
I
like
remember my husband and I used to stay out in the shop till like 10 o'clock at night, 11 o'clock, till the room will cool off because it doesn't have any insulation. It's nothing but wood. And we used to lay in the back of his truck and just talk about the future and what we were gonna do, where we were gonna vacation at. And it was, I think it was that vision of what we could do for our family that just kept us going, working 15, 16 hours a day and sleeping in the back of his truck till the room will cool off. Or in the winter, it felt like it was 40 degree weather in the room. But yeah, that was it. We were able to save a bit, at least save our 3% to get into a house within 2 years.
Man, your house is pretty cool because you have the house and then you have a coach house.
Yes, it's a duplex.
So then, como se llama, and after you got your home, right? When was it that you, how many years later passed by? Because I want to get to talking about your project here in Chicago, because your dream was always to come back and buy your own piece of property here in Chicago.
Buy my own little piece of Chicago, my slice of Chicago. So we bought it in 2014, and by 2020, we refinanced. So 6 years later, we were able to refinance. We were able to buy into the market at such a good price still, thank God, that our house appreciated a lot within 6 years. So when we refinanced, we were able to get the mortgage insurance off of our mortgage. Mm-hmm. And that was able to afford us to get a good chunk of money out of the equity in the house. And then 2 years later, we refinanced again when the rates dropped significantly. We were able to take advantage of that. We refinanced again. And that second refinance was able to, you know, give me the opportunity to buy my slice of Chicago.
You know, and that's one of the best parts, like in real estate, right? When you're able to get in the wave at a perfect time. But yes. The thing that I've always admired you for, Janet, is always being prepared for the opportunity and being prepared for the times, right? Because then, okay, you're like, I have this equity, my interest rate is going to go so low. And so when you realize that you had this equity, right, and that you were going to be able to do something with it, what gave you the courage to say, you know what, I'm going to go fulfill my dreams to Chicago and get my piece of property that I always said I would?
You know, a lot of people think that they want to finish paying their house right away, right? To me, and I've listened to a lot of investors that say that not all debt is bad. You have good debt. So mortgage to me is one of those good debts. Like, I don't care to finish paying my house in the next 10 years. If that house is going to be my bank, I'm going to be able to take money out and be able to invest in something else. Of course, don't go taking money out just so you could vacation and now you're in for another 10 years on your mortgage. But if you have a vision and your house could fund that vision, why not? So it did take a lot. Like, I was pushing a lot. My husband was like, oh, I don't know what you're doing. And to me, it's like God gave me a vision that it wouldn't stop. It just kept coming and coming about buying a building in Chicago. And then it was not just buying the building in Chicago, but now it was about building something that will help my community, that will help kids, that will give kids an extra push to do something that unfortunately I wasn't that fortunate to have when I finished high school. I wanted to be an actress. I wanted to be in movie production. And I couldn't go to school. I had to get real with myself that I was undocumented and that I wouldn't be able to do anything with going to school for movie production or acting. And I thought, I got to get real, right? So I went into the job force. I got a regular job. Thank God has blessed my life to be able to have this little piece of Chicago. And now I'm able to give back to my community through it. At least I'm pushing for that. So,
well, let me tell y'all that, you know, it wasn't that easy. I think you took some time to mentally prepare for the time that you were gonna buy a property, because she spent like 2 years, right? Like, Sandra, I want to buy a building in Chicago. I want to go fulfill this dream. And so she kept on sending it, but I know when someone has a vision, and that's I love it. And I especially love being a part of it. So let me tell you that she right now, Janet owns a mixed use building in Little Village, right on 27th and Lawndale. Two upstairs, you have two apartments, but one of the big apartment that she has, she actually turned it into an Airbnb. And it's so beautiful. It's so beautiful. And people would ask, like, why would you do an Airbnb in Little Village, right? Like, really? And people would stay there. And what is your answer to that?
You know,
Why in Little Village?
first we got priced out of Pilsen where we grew up, right? It got gentrified and we got priced out. Going into Pilsen was out of the question. You're talking about almost a million or over a million to buy into Pilsen. And my other dear place to my heart is Little Village. My parents and I used to pass a lot of time in Little Village. And Little Village has such a bad connotation when it comes to people talking about Chicago, right? They think it's just gang infested. And that's so far from the truth. Do we have problems with that? Yes, like a lot of parts of Chicago. But Little Village is full of culture. It's full of beautiful people that will open their arms and say, "Hey, welcome, buenos dias." Like, I wanted to be a little bit of that change to change that connotation of people having that bad vision of Chicago, of Little Village. And I know that there's so many other people that feel like me. There's so many other small businesses that feel like me that are thriving in Little Village. So, yeah.
I'm gonna put the link to her Airbnb because I really want you guys to take a look at it. She's been super blessed and it's been booked, right? For like a it's been
Yeah,
booked for a few months
I
now.
got it out in November and it's booked right now all the way till June. So I feel super blessed. I remember when people were coming in to check it out, they were like, "This doesn't even feel like Little Village. It's like a mid-century, very Mexican-oriented mid-century loft apartment."
And it's kind of like
And
way
when they
not,
said
right?
that, I was like, "No, I want people to leave out of here saying, 'What a beautiful space in Little Village.'" That is what represents Little Village.
And it's like right down the street from one of like the oldest, most delicious restaurant, in Little Village. And then you have a bakery with the cinnamon cookies. You got churros, you got tacos, you got everything
You got
there. So thank you so much.
churros, okay? You got churros on the street, so
So thank you so much for even like coming back, and we tend to go back into our community and give back. So the your Airbnb is called La Casa de Mi Mamá,
yeah, that's part of the vision.
and then now the second vision is going to be the art gallery that you're going to have in the first floor, as well as you want to do the open kitchen to the community so that kids could start learning how to cook
How
for
to
themselves a
cook.
little better.
Yeah. We will be doing after school programming for kids to learn to immerse themselves into the arts, and not only to learn the art, but to learn the business side of it, of how to make money with it. Unfortunately, in communities of color, arts are not that encouraged in our homes. The first thing that they tell you is that you're going to be broke. And I want to take that out as well. I want to show kids that if you have a community behind you, you could thrive in the arts and you can make real good money in the arts as well. So it's just about putting a program together for that and also teaching kids how to cook, how to be self-sufficient when it comes to the kitchen and be able to help your parents as well. A lot of people in our communities, they work two jobs to maintain their family. Their kids are going home to an empty house and not having the greatest food to eat because their parents are at work. So why not have an after-school program that teaches kids how to cook hearty foods that are going to be sustainable and that are going to bring their family together? Have the kids learn and maybe even teach the parents how to cook some healthy foods.
Man, that's why I love you, girl, because you're I just love, we love community, and I can't wait for to see that project in fruition. It's actually one of the things that I do pray for you, my friend, because
Thank you.
it's great, and I'll be there to support you with that program. And then before we wrap it up, I want you to give everybody advice as far as there was an incident that happened when you bought the your property with one of the tenants.
Yes. So the biggest encouragement that I will give people is do not be afraid to invest. However, you do have to be very mindful that you don't know if you don't know the business 100%, and even if you do, I feel that even if you are a seasoned investor, like you should still talk to a lawyer, be able to be
Important.
willing to invest money and speaking to a lawyer on what are the things that you're supposed to do as a landlord. Unfortunately, when I came in, I didn't know everything. And I think that you never know everything, right? But I was supposed to have given a letter to the tenants, letting them know where their deposit was going to be at and what bank, and get a specific account for their deposits. I didn't do that. And failing to do that, the tenants, even though I was a great landlord to them for the 7 months that they were in my apartment, unfortunately, they took advantage of that. They took me to court for that. And I was standing to lose over $30,000 if I would go to court. I ended up settling for $10,000, but I feel like getting informed prior to jumping in, or once you're in the midst of it, like really paying a lawyer to tell you how to move forward for with paperwork, it will save you a lot of headaches. $2,000 probably would have saved me the $10,000 and the headache that I had for about 6 months.
Yeah, and we'll, hopefully we'll be having Libby Popovich next week so she can answer some questions that people do have regarding becoming a landlord and tenants, because I know that a lot of people feel a lot more comfortable as a landlord to ask for a deposit, to have, like how we've been used to all this time. And actually now, like you were advised, like not to even take a deposit.
Yeah, so there's a fee that you could charge, non-refundable entrance fee.
It's like a move-in.
So for the cleaning and all that stuff, and you don't have to keep tabs on to put it on a separate account to keep on paying the tenant for their interest, because even if you don't pay that dollar or $2 interest a year, they could take you to court and win two times their deposit. So, yeah, I was l really encouraged to not take any deposits going forward, but more to take a non-refundable fee, entrance fee. So,
Well, thank you for sharing that. Well, sharing everything about you and how you were able to, get as successful as you are right now. And this is just the beginning because you
yes,
have
it is.
like the next project that is coming up. And there's another project that you had mentioned that I didn't mention it today, but I'm gonna wait until the next time we have you on here so you can share, get an update about where Janet is at. So once again, thank you so much, my friend, for being here. You know that I love you, I support you, and I am, extremely proud of everything that you have accomplished. So can't wait to see everything else.
Sandra, thank you so much for having me. Thank you for being the catalyst for this because you've been a big part of it. You believing in me and being crazy enough to just keep encouraging, keep sending me sending me listings when probably you even knew that I wasn't quite ready, but just that encouragement that I have for 2 years telling me you could do it. Here's a link to this house. Here's a link to this building. Like that kept it alive for me. Right. And seriously, you've been a big part of it. And I thank you so much. And I think that this is just the beginning, even for both of us working together. So I pray that this vision that you have with this podcast will help thousands of people, that it will get much bigger than just Chicago. And I can't wait to see it too.
Man, I want to be the next Oprah. Hey. I'm like Christina. Remember Christina?
Christina Saralegui. Yes. Yes. Yes, you can. Yes, you can.
But I'm like, you know, it's like there's a lot of information that sometimes people don't know because we don't spread the information around. You know, I just want to hopefully have this platform, build it a little bit more. And it's the beginning. OK, so no judging. No judging, guys. Yeah. But thank you so much. It's 8 o'clock in the morning. I hope everyone has an amazing and beautiful day. Buenos dias, Sandra Diaz. Talk to you soon.